All right, so welcome to this second video in my series on tensors. In the last video, I tried to give you a few reasons for why you might want to learn about tensors. In this video, I'm going to try and explain what exactly tensors are. So tensors are a little hard to describe if you've never heard of them before. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you several different definitions that you might hear from different people when you ask them what a tensor is. And hopefully seeing all these different points of view will put you in a good starting position so that you feel comfortable when we actually start doing real math in the next video. Okay, so let's get started. Here's a first attempt at a definition for tensors. I'll just read it off. So a tensor is a multi-dimensional array of numbers. And by array, I basically just mean grid. So a grid of numbers. Okay, so let's see some examples of what this might look like. So the simplest example of a tensor is what we would call a scalar, or sometimes a rank zero tensor. And a scalar is basically just a number. So any number like 1, 2, 5, 3 quarters, pi, these are all examples of scalars. And we don't normally write scalars as arrays, but if we wanted to, we could write little square brackets around the scalar like this and sort of pretend it's an array, but we don't normally do that. All right, so those are scalars. Another example of a tensor you've hopefully seen before is a vector, or a rank one tensor. And we call it a rank one tensor because it's a list of numbers that extends downward in one dimension. So it's like a one-dimensional array. So that's a vector. Another example you've probably heard of are matrices, or rank two tensors. And we call them rank two because they are a two-dimensional grid of numbers, so they extend up, down, left to right. And if you recall from the last video, I mentioned that the metric tensor from general relativity is a rank 2 tensor. And these little Greek letters that you see here actually stand for numbers that represent the row and column of the particular entry of the matrix that we're talking about. So the metric tensor is really just a matrix. And we can go higher and higher. This is a rank 3 tensor because it's in a three-dimensional grid of numbers, sort of arranged in a cube. And we can go on and on, rank 4, 5, 6, as high as we want. So any multidimensional array of numbers is a tensor. So I call this the array definition of tensors. Okay, so I said that this was a first attempt at a definition. And it does give us some idea of what a tensor is. But this definition is actually wrong. And here's why. So tensors can be represented as multidimensional arrays, but that's not what they fundamentally are. Tensors aren't just a bunch of numbers that we toss together. Tensors actually have real geometrical meaning. And if we just think of tensors as these multidimensional arrays, we sort of miss out on the geometrical meaning behind them. So if we casually toss the word tensor around to mean a multidimensional array of numbers, you know, that's sort of fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But if we're thinking seriously like mathematicians and we want to understand geometry, this definition, the array definition, is simply just wrong. So it's no good to us. Okay, so let's try again. So here's another attempt at a definition. I'll just read it. A tensor is an object that is invariant under a change of coordinates and has components that change in a special predictable way under a change of coordinates. Okay, so that's certainly a mouthful. So what does that mean? So let's start with the top part. What does it mean to be invariant under a change of coordinates? Well, to explain that, I'd like you to try picking up a pencil and point the pencil toward the nearest door that you can see. So there are a few things that we can say about this pencil that are just facts, and they don't depend on any coordinate system. So for example, the length of the pencil, the length won't depend on our choice of coordinate system. The length is an intrinsic or invariant quantity. Also, this pencil is pointing toward the door, and that's just a fact. It doesn't depend on what coordinate system we use. The pencil's orientation is intrinsic or invariant under the choice of coordinate system. Now the second part, what does it mean for components to transform predictably under a change of coordinates? Well, to start off, let's introduce a coordinate system here. So we have a nice 3D coordinate system with three vectors here that give us the main coordinate directions. And what we can do is we can measure the pencil using this coordinate system. All right, so it looks like this pencil is made up of two yellow arrows, one green arrow, and then two blue arrows. All right, so we can write this pencil as a linear combination of the coordinate vectors here. Okay, so what we just did here by breaking down the pencil into the coordinate vectors is we measured the pencil's components. The components are just the amount of each coordinate vector that we need to construct the pencil, right? So in this, with this coordinate system, the components are 2, 1, 2. Now, I introduced this coordinate system here, and you might think it's a pretty sensible coordinate system because all the direction vectors are the same length and they're all perpendicular to each other, so that's kind of nice. But really, there's nothing special about this coordinate system, right? I could just as easily introduce another coordinate system like this, where the vectors are all different lengths and they all sit at weird angles relative to each other. But mathematically, neither of these is more correct than another. They're simply just different choices. And so with this second coordinate system, I can sort of do the same thing. I can measure the pencil along each coordinate vector, and I can see that this pencil is made up of two black vectors, three purple vectors, and then one red vector. And again, I can write the pencil as a linear combination of these vectors, and I get the components 1, 3, 2. So you'll notice when I measure the pencil using different coordinate systems, I actually get different components, right? And this is a really important idea. The pencil's components are not invariant, right? They change depending on the coordinate system they use. Okay, so the pencil is invariant, but the coordinates are not invariant. Okay, that's a very important idea. So now it turns out that if we know how to change one coordinate system into another coordinate system, right, so if we know how to go back and forth between these two coordinate systems, then we should also be able to figure out how to change back and forth between these different sets of components. And this process of going back and forth between coordinate systems and components, that's what I'm going to call forward and backward transformations. And I'm going to talk about those in the next video. All right, so backing up, what a tensor is an object that is invariant. It doesn't depend on a coordinate system, but its components, which do depend on the coordinate system, change in some special predictable way that we can figure out using these forward and backward transformations. And this is what I'm going to call the coordinate definition of a tensor. And this definition is actually pretty good. It does get to what the heart of a tensor is. It's an object that's invariant, but whose components change. But it turns out that we can come up with an even better definition. And so I'm going to switch to that one here. So here's our third final definition. I'm just going to read it off. A tensor is a collection of vectors and covectors combined together using the tensor product. So this definition ends up being really nice. It's really short and sweet. There's just one problem. If you've never studied tensors before, you may have heard of vectors, but you've probably never heard of a covector, and you've probably never heard of the tensor product. So the downside of this definition is that we need to put in a little bit of work before we can even understand what it means. But once we understand what all these things mean, it's actually a really simple definition. Tensors are just vectors and covectors combined together in different ways using this thing called the tensor product. So this is what I call the abstract definition of a tensor. So this is really the best definition of a tensor we can come up with. And I'll get to this definition later on in the video series once we have the basics down. All right, and I have a little bonus part here. So for those who do have a calculus background, I'm going to talk about how tensors pop up in calculus. And that's when we see tensors as partial derivatives and gradients that transform with the Jacobian matrix. So you can skip this section if you aren't feeling very strong with your calculus skills. It's an extremely interesting use of tensors, and it's very important for the curved geometry we might see in general relativity. If you're not comfortable with calculus, you can feel free to skip over this part. All right, so this is sort of the end of the introduction. I spent the last two videos just sort of preparing your brain for what tensors are. In the next video, I'm actually going to start doing real math, and we're going to start with forward and backward transformations. So I will see you in the next one.